You may not be figuring out what really is bringing you joy, what really is bringing you that challenge that's
Yeah.
going to make you happy and fulfilled, and how you build a career into the future.
Welcome to Hearts and Carts, the CPG podcast, the podcast about the people behind the products that are winning hearts and filling carts. This cast is for anyone with an interest in the world of consumer products. We're your hosts, Justin Osborne and Alex Hill, and our mission is to bring you weekly content that helps you be a better and more informed CPG professional.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of Hearts and Carts. I'm your host, Justin Osborne, along with Alex Hill, our co-host. Alex, who do we have on the show today?
Today, we're going to be talking with Sarah Chadwick, who is the chief of sales at Jelmar. Jelmar is a company that makes cleaning products, including the brands CLR and Tarnex. And Sarah's had a long career in CPG over 20 years. Working at companies like SC Johnson and Procter & Gamble as well, and was a mentor to both of us. Yeah, without further ado, we can start moving things into the conversation with Sarah. Don't forget to like and subscribe, follow us on our various social platforms, and let's have a conversation.
Stop. Have a time. Every time you see me, my hammer's just on height. I'm built on the floor, and I'm magic on the mic. Now, why would I ever stop?
Hey, Sarah.
Hi, boys.
How are you?
I am okay. How are you both? I can't believe, Justin, that you're a dad. Sometimes that really freaks me out because it really makes me feel old. I don't know what it is. Both of you guys, like, having lives and wives and kids, and it's like, holy crap. So
Makes me feel a little weird too.
Well, it makes me feel really old. So, you know, you're not there yet. So anyway, so what's going on, Alex? How was Florida?
Florida was great. It was fun. I made it to Disney World for the first time in my life. So,
I
filled in that gap in my childhood, and I am now an adult. Finally, it was the one thing missing. So
there you go. It's funny. Like, we've taken the kids up, you know, probably three or four or five times over their lifetime. And my kids were never particularly enamored with Disney. When they were really little, there were a couple of rides here and there they really liked. Like, there's a Buzz Lightyear ride where you shoot things, and they loved that, you know. And then there was a go-kart type Cars themed ride. And other than that, they're like, eh. They had a lot more fun at Universal Studios when I took them, a girlfriend of mine and I took them, say 5 years ago now. We actually went over the Halloween week. It was really kind of neat. But they had a lot more fun at that because of the videos and the cool rides of Universal. But I'm actually not sad that I never have to go back to Disney. I am not sad. So
I think I have the opposite problem. I think Leo is obsessed with Disney princesses. Like, he's obsessed with Frozen and Rapunzel and all these princesses. So I think we're going to be spending a lot of time and money at Disney World in the near future.
Well, there's a really good chart that you can dig up on Reddit, in the Data is Beautiful subreddit. It often pops up and it shows how fast the price has risen of Disney park admission versus like the consumer price index. Like, it's terrifying with the amount of money that it is, you know. And every year it's like, wow, it basically doubled again. And it's like $400 for 3 days. And you're like, okay, and people just pay it. So I am not sad that we are out of that path.
So today with us, we have Sarah Chadwick, who is the chief of sales at Jelmar. She had a long career at SC Johnson. Before that, she was actually the person that hired me to my first full-time role at SCJ. So she gave me a shot to start there that turned into a pretty good career in CPG that I'm happy with. So thankful to her for that, of course. And Alex and I both at different times reported into her and worked with her. And we were talking about Disney World. I actually went to Disney World with you one time through work, as weird as odd as that is.
That's true.
That was a good time. But I'm excited to have you on just to talk about your career through CPG on both sides of the border, what that's like. And the idea is for younger listeners who are getting into the CPG world, how do we share some insight into your career, you know, how successful you've been, some of the decisions you made, why you made them, and then, of course, advice for them. So maybe we could just start with a bit about you and your career and sort of start us back at the beginning.
Yeah, no, that's great. And one, I'm totally thrilled to be talking to you guys. And when I talk about people and people that I've coached and mentored all over the years, my favorite story is always the Costco intern story, which maybe we'll get to in a moment, Alex. I always hold up both of you as, you know, some of what I feel as, you know, my two of my favorites. Probably had over 40 people report to me over the course of my, you know, almost 25-year career in the industry. And you both of you were easily two of my favorite. Not only because of just who you are as people, but also because of how quickly you grew in your role and how you've continued to develop and grow. And it's been super fun actually watching your careers from kind of the sidelines. You know, Alex is, with him still being at SC Johnson, I really had a good pipeline into how he was doing. And then, you know, Justin, after you left, you know, still kind of following you through LinkedIn and other things. It's been really fun to watch the both of you grow. So, but a little bit about me and my background. So it actually kind of got to start as to where I went to university and what I was going to do and what I ended up doing. So I actually went to Queens and I was supposed to be a phys ed teacher in small town Brockville, Ontario. So I went to Queens. Mm-hmm. I have a phys ed degree, honors phys ed degree, and an honors history degree. And I was supposed to go, and there was a gentleman who was going to retire right when I finished teacher's college. And that was the plan. But then after my second year of undergrad, I worked for an organization called Sales and Merchandising Group, which has changed names over time. And the most recent iteration is Mosaic. And they were really a field marketing services company. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, this was back in summer of 1994. And I had a 1981 Dodge Omni that I drove around Eastern Ontario, selling Pepsi cooler barrels into convenience stores and gas stations. And I was driving up to like Tweed, Ontario, and Kingston and Carlton Place, Ontario, and talking to these people. And then, you know, I sold them the cooler barrel in the first couple of weeks. And then every couple of weeks I went back to get them to order more product to put in it. And I totally fell in love. I was like, this is amazing. You know, I had a real knack for selling. And I just thought it was fun. And so I was like, nuts to teaching. I'm going to go to business school. But I still finished my undergraduate degrees, and graduated, with honors from Queens, because those two degrees really taught me a lot that I then leverage and continue to leverage. So the history degree really teaches you how to think critically, how to look at, you know, a point in time, or how to look at a situation and think about it critically and try to remove some of the emotion. You know, the benefit of looking at history is you kind of get rid of all of the emotion in, you know, that people were feeling at the time. And you just look at the decisions that were made and why they were made and how then that affected things going forward. So I use that all the time now. And then the phys ed degree, which, you know, some people affectionately call a gym degree, was actually a lot about organizational behavior, coaching, learning how to motivate people, and also how to teach. And, you know, I do credit that background with creating, you know, my ability to create a team, my ability to facilitate a conversation and an organization and a group of people, you know. So I absolutely, while I don't actively, you know, work in those industries, I really use the tools that came out of those two undergraduate degrees. In even today, you know, a few days ago, I was thinking about, you know, I have some interesting relationships that I'm managing within my teams at work. And I'm using some of those organizational behavioral skills still to this day. And I mean, that's 30 some years ago. So it's really kind of neat. And then since I decided I wasn't going to go to teacher's college, I went to business school. So I went to Dalhousie University in Halifax, Nova Scotia, and did an MBA. So a lot of people take a few years between their undergrad degrees and their graduate degree. I actually didn't. I went straight from my undergrad into my program at Dalhousie. And, you know, a lot of people are like, wow, Nova Scotia, that's different. You know, I actually didn't apply to any schools within Ontario because I realized I needed a different perspective on the country. And so I had only applied to schools on the East Coast and the West Coast and picked Dalhousie mostly because it was near the ocean and I've got this big love affair with whales. So so I went to Dal. I did a program with a double major in international business and marketing, and then was recruited out of Dalhousie to start my career in marketing at Procter & Gamble. So in 1999, I graduated and moved to Toronto and joined P&G's brand class of 1999, which was a great experience. You know, I spent 2 years at P&G and really had the best foundational training in marketing that really exists in the CPG world. You know, the Canadian class was paired with the US brand class. So we had all the same training. I spent, you know, weeks and weeks in Cincinnati at the headquarters and had access to all the same training that any of the American brand managers did. And I really, really liked it. I loved the industry. I started my career working on Tide. I mean, how could you not want to work on a flagship brand for one of the largest companies in the world? And it was amazing. You know, I got to do TV advertising and, you know, then I moved on to the Febreze business and I developed this entire program around the CHL and I brokered a partnership with the CHL. I got to sponsor the Canadian women's gold medal game, you know, through Febreze and I got to do some really neat things. I got to do some amazing research. You know, I helped launch Febreze antibacterial. And I just really, you know, kind of drove myself and my career from a marketing perspective. And so, after about I was 2 years into my career at Procter & Gamble, and I really loved the industry, but I was struggling a little bit with fit of the organization. At the time, P&G in Toronto was very inwardly competitive. And I was much more of a, I'm a super competitive person. And any, you know, my kids and my husband look at me like I'm like crazy competitive person. But I didn't want to compete with the people I was working with. I wanted to compete with, you know, the other brands. If I was on Febreze, I wanted to compete with Glade. Or if I was on Tide, I wanted to compete with Sunlight. Like, I didn't want to compete with the guy who ran Swiffer. I thought, I didn't see the value in that. So I started to kind of look around and I interviewed at a number of locations and you know, was fortunate enough to have a number of job offers. But what really attracted me to SC Johnson was it was a very different culture at the time. So in the Canadian office, which is in Brantford, Ontario, it was a much smaller team for sure than the marketing team that I had at P&G. And it was just much more collaborative and not just within the marketing function itself, but from a cross-functional standpoint. And so then this really gave me the opportunity to learn more about other functions, finance, sales, customer marketing, and that type of thing. So then I did that and I was in marketing at SCJ. And, you know, kind of moved up the ranks to category director, mostly on the air care business, on the Glade, running Glade and Oust. But I also did have a good stint on the Edge personal care business before SCJ sold that. And that was super fun because I got to manage the contract of Doug Gilmore because he was our spokesperson at the time. So I got to spend a little bit of time going to charity hockey tournaments and stuff, which was really great. So that was fun. But then I kind of got to this point in my career, and this happens to a lot of people in Canada, is that there's not that many spots to keep going up in staying in the same function. Yes. And at the time, I really wanted to stay at SC Johnson. I love the company. It worked for my family. And so I actually kind of took what many people called a crazy leap of faith at the time and moved into the sales organization. And I can't, you know, if I have one piece of advice for people coming out of this whole 45 minutes or however long we're going to talk, it is look at an opportunity for what it can provide to you, not that it's a move sideways, because that completely changed my perspective when I moved into sales. And so I kind of started over. I went back down to an account manager level, and I was calling on customers in the DIY class of trade. So home hardware, Home Depot and Lowe's, yeah. And then eventually Canadian Tire. And, you know, these were accounts that I had very little exposure to running the air care business, because there's not as much business on fragrance in home hardware, right? Yeah. Than what you would have at like a Walmart, for example. So I really started to understand the perspective and started to go like, man, when I was in marketing and I just said to the sales force, guys, just go sell at a price increase, I thought it was easy. I realized it's not as easy as you think it would be to sell at a price increase, you know, and I brought a lot of strategic thinking and objective setting to sales that was not generally inherent at the time within the organization. So then I kind of worked my way back up, and that's when I had the opportunity to both recruit and coach both of you fine gentlemen. When I was the Costco Warehouse Club DIY director. And, you know, that has been one of the most rewarding roles that I've had, even to this day, in my entire career. You know, the sense of responsibility, the stakes that were apparent, you know, with the Costco contract and different things, you know, that I was responsible for, and the exposure that that gave me then also led me to the opportunity to move to the U.S. So, you know, at the time we were working very closely with the U.S. Warehouse Club team, and the chief sales officer for SCJ at the time, his name was Darwin Lewis, and he's the one that gave me the nickname the Velvet.
Yeah, I don't know if you noticed when you joined, the song that we were playing was MC Hammer.
Yes.
For that exact reason. I was wondering if you picked up on that.
I got it. I picked it up. So, but yeah, like, and I have tried to live the rest of my career very much with that thought in mind of the Velvet Hammer, because it's really something unique, and it's generally only applied to women in the industry, because, you know, the hammer part is about being firm and, you know, making sure that you're secure in what you're doing and that you get what you need out of it. But the velvet is the really important part. And I think I've probably talked to you both about this at some point, where in order to, you know, get people to work with you, get people to be positive and the relationships are positive, you got to kind of wrap the stuff in bubble, or you wrap the hammer in the velvet. And sometimes you have a really thick layer of velvet, and sometimes the layer of velvet may be a little thinner because you really need to push a little harder. But it's really important to me. And I have really tried to live the rest of my career with, you know, with that in the back of my mind. And so I moved to the US in March of 2015, which was a huge, crazy leap of faith. You know, if you had asked my husband and I 2 years before if we would ever move to the US, the answer would have been, of course not. We're Canadian and we're going to stay here. But, you know, the opportunity was really great. And I got a ton out of moving. You know, I moved into the customer marketing team, and I started to be able to get exposure to even more senior leaders within the SCJ organization. And I started on the Glade business again, which was, I think, my fourth go around with Glade type thing at SCJ. So it was kind of my comfort zone, I guess. And it was a really interesting move for us. And we can talk about that more if you're interested about the difference in the move and, you know, difference between the organizations. Yeah. But from a career standpoint, I spent the next 5 years really in customer marketing, and I continued to grow and, you know, became a director, and then, you know, had responsibility for Ziploc for all of North America, which was really cool. And I had one of the best working relationships of my entire life with the marketing senior director at the time, a gentleman named Kurt Hegvold, who was actually an Australian. So we had a great, you know, we were the Commonwealth working in, you know, Chicago together, and that was really cool. But, you know, spent 5 years working in customer marketing, both on Ziploc and then back again for the fifth tour on Glade. And then after that, I really wanted to go back into sales. And it was kind of interesting because I had ended up taking over the Albertsons team for SC Johnson. And my first day was in March of 2020. And it was literally the day that the world shut down because of COVID was my first day on that role. And what was hilarious about that was I was so excited because I had spent the last 4 years commuting back and forth on the train from Racine to Chicago, and this new job was working from home. And so this was my first day in my home office, and the entire country came and worked at home with me. So it was like, wow, I didn't know I had that much of an effect on people, but that was great. And I spent the next 2 years doing that role. And I, again, had great people working for me and stuff. And, I really thought I would spend my whole career at SCJ. But then, a friend of a friend reached out and was like, hey, we have this cool opportunity at Jelmar. And for those of you who might not know who Jelmar is, we are a very small company, but we make CLR, the calcium lime rust products, and a number of other home cleaning items as well. And this was an opportunity for me to really stretch myself organizationally. So going from a director on one of 40 directors within the North American business to being the chief sales officer for the company. And it was, it was a little terrifying, I will admit, because now the buck kind of stops at me. There's when I was at SC Johnson, there was, some senior director, there was another director, some senior directors, a VP of sales, an SVP of North. Like, there's lots of people who stuff has to flow up to, people to make decisions, people to set the strategy. Now it's me, like, it's literally me. So, that was very daunting. And I've now been there for almost 7 months, and it's really fascinating. And I'm getting out of it exactly what I had hoped, which was, the ability to influence the direction of the company, the ability to set the strategy for the business moving forward. Some of the conversations I'm having and leading and facilitating, I probably never would have had that level of responsibility, even if my career continued on the same progression at SCJ. There are things I absolutely miss about SC. It's very different going from an organization with thousands of employees and lots of resources to an organization with literally 22 full-time employees. We don't have all of the category insights people. And, there's you guys would both laugh, but I'm like rolling up my sleeves and pulling IRI data. Like, when was the last time I did that? Right. And as two people who used to have to pull data for me, I'm sure you can imagine how inept I am still at doing it. But it's really been a great opportunity and a good transition. And it's, a nice, flexible hybrid work environment. So I feel really comfortable, at this point in my life and this point in my career with where I'm at.
That was a great overview.
Yeah.
So. I hope so. I think the first place I want to go is just before we even talk serious career stuff. Who do you miss more, Justin or I?
Oh, that's not fair. it's funny. Like, Justin was the earnest one, right? Like, Justin was the one that
I like where this is going.
Okay. Like, if I was really struggling or I needed something, I knew Justin would get it done, right? Like, I... every confidence. And then on the other hand, if I was down, Alex was the funny one. Like, Alex was always who could, just with this like, aw shucks look on his face. And it's something that is just uniquely you, Alex. And I miss that. Like, I mean, I'm really serious when I say you guys were two of the people that I really appreciated coaching the most. And for many reasons, just the people who you are, but also because you were two people who were super hungry for coaching. And that's one thing that I always appreciated about you both, right? Like, if I gave you feedback, and occasionally I would give you critical or constructive feedback, I mean, you owned it, you internalized it, and you did changes or moved forward in a way that doesn't really happen very often. So I can't really say I miss either of you more. Now, Justin did, move a couch with his truck. So there was, that is a win in the Justin column.
Justin needs a win here. So
I need a win.
So just saying, but, and my kids do know Justin better. Because, Alex, you didn't come to the house quite as often.
It's fair.
Plus, Justin also gets the Stephanie factor, right? Because
that's true.
Because she worked with my husband.
It's true.
So there's a thing there too. So I'm not gonna pick favorites because I try not to do that even with my own children. But everybody brings different things to the table. How about that?
No, that's fair.
Yeah, it sounded like you picked a favorite, but we can move on.
Totally. I'll stay away from that.
So I think let's go back a little bit. I would like to hear more about the transition from marketing to sales, because I sort of did the opposite, but that's something that I think a lot of people, they do get stuck going down that career path of like just marketing or just sales. And I think that cross-functional experience is so important for yourself, but also for organizations. And by the time I got to SCJ, that was something they were doing quite regularly, but I don't know that a lot of companies do that. So maybe you could talk about the differences that you found and sort of the learnings you got from that.
Yeah, it's a great point in my career because it's a real pivot point, right? Mm-hmm. And, the things that you learn about in marketing are strategic thinking, objective setting, consumer insights, how do you craft a plan that delivers on a concept that you've developed to, after you've identified a white space opportunity for a product. And now you have to figure out how to get the consumer to be excited about it. And those are all really good and important and difficult skills, develop advertising, develop the innovation on its own and working with R&D, and then when you get into sales, I kind of look at sales as the proof is in the pudding type of a thing. And what really attracted me to sales was the very tangible nature of sales. So, I spent 9 years working in marketing. I produced a number of TV commercials. I have no idea if any of those commercials, and a couple of them won awards, whether they got a single person to buy a product. I don't know whether they got a single customer of ours to order that product. I mean, I think they did because they were pretty good, but I don't know that. And the difference between marketing and sales is, and especially with the accounts that I started with, I went in and I was managing the home hardware account, and they have 2 trade shows every year where all like 1500 dealers come to St. Jacobs and they walk around in the booths. And I made you both work the shows with me. So
I love those shows, actually.
Was super fun. Yeah. But that was so tangible because I would have this conversation with a dealer from Timmins, Ontario, and then they would submit an order and I could see it. And I'm like, I just sold 4 Glade holiday candle displays to this store in Timmins, Ontario. So I was it was so tangible that I knew that my effort was what got that to happen. Now, did I have marketing develop the displays? Of course. Are they, built with consumer insights that these are the fragrances that people want? Of course. But at the end of the day, that person would only have the opportunity to buy that product because I was standing there and talked him through that. And I thought that was amazing. And so, when I came into sales, I brought this marketing thought of, you got to have these big strategies and everything else. And what I learned was a lot of it was also about how do you build relationships? Like in marketing, you are generally the client, right? And you deal with a bunch of agencies, and their job is to, make you happy as the client, right? And, they're bringing you the data and they are servicing you and everything else. Whereas in sales, it's literally the opposite. You are the vendor going to a retailer. You've got to work on their schedule. You've got to figure out what is important to that retailer, because how Home Depot goes to market is very different than how Walmart goes to market in Canada or Loblaws, so you really had to take your narrative, your consumer narrative, and fit it into what is important and what is the go-to-market strategy for the retailer. And so I took from marketing how to build that narrative, but what I learned in sales was how to make that relevant to the retailer. Because you can have the best consumer narrative. You can have the best designed product, you can have the best TV commercial and a concept score that is like 100% top two box, but if it's not on the shelf at Loblaw, it doesn't matter because nobody can buy your product. And that that's a little bit less true now because of, you know, the growth of digital and direct to consumer and different things. But this is 14, 15 years ago that I started in sales. Yeah. And it really, that really didn't exist nearly as much. Like, I mean, we were just dipping our toe in the water with e-commerce and omni-channel. You know, they didn't even have the concept of omni-channel when I first went into sales. Yeah. It was really just called like this online e-commerce thing that nobody really understood. And, you know, so, and what I appreciate then about the differences and how sales then has, sales has really changed as a discipline, you know, like, when I did my MBA, and you guys can think about that as well, I spent 2 years doing graduate work in business, and they never talked about sales once, like never, They might have talked a little bit about negotiation, which a lot of sales is negotiation. Yeah. Like marketing isn't negotiation. Marketing is all about you tell the agency, here's what we need, and the agency comes back with what do you have, and then you approve it or not based on a brief. In sales, it's really all about how do you negotiate? How do you get to that collective win with your retailer? It's a very different skill set, right? And I was very fortunate that I've had some exceptional training in negotiation from Fotini Economopoulos through the Gap partnership. And if you have not read her book, I would highly recommend. There's a plug for Fotini, and I'm not even getting paid for that, but her book is awesome. Economopoulos. So if you can spell that, then you can find her book. But you know, that really, the art of negotiation is really about, you know, how do you take what you need, but also deliver what they need? Because what the retailer is looking for is more in trade investment. They're looking for a higher retail margin, which is the exact opposite of what the marketing team wants you to deliver.
Yeah.
Right. So it's a totally different skill set. You're internally negotiating to get more money to support your business. You're internally negotiating to get a display vehicle that works for your retailer, you know, because Home Hardware said, well, I don't want a 36 count candle display. I want a 24 count candle display, but that doesn't make us as much money. So, you know, how do we work through that? So there are really tangible differences between the skill sets that you need for both. And then when I moved into customer marketing in my career, it was like this intersection of the, right? And that is really like, was really a sweet spot for me for a number of years, because, you know, the internal focused part of the customer marketing role really pulled from, you know, my marketing days of setting strategy and, you know, really analyzing the data in the business and figuring out what the narrative was and how to launch innovation, you know, but it also still, I was the face of the brand then to a number of retailers. So if we, you know, my biggest innovation I launched was the Disney program for Ziploc. And I spent, you know, I probably spent 20 weeks out of 30 on the road at different retailers selling in the Disney program, you know, supporting the sales organization and that type of thing. So like, I look at my career and it's funny, you know, as you get older, you people reach out to you for recruiters and they're like, wow, you've got such a diverse background, because very, very few people have done what I have done. You know, most people do what I call a rotation. So they will, you know, they'll be a marketer and they come in and they do a sales rotation and they're there for like 18 months and then they run away screaming because they want to go back to marketing. Or people are starting career in sales and they are kind of forced to do a customer marketing rotation and they hope that checks the box for marketing. They may have to go do a brand manager or an assistant brand manager role for 18 months and then they run back to sales. And I've had more than two recruiters refer to me as the CPG unicorn, because I have multiple roles at multiple levels in marketing, multiple roles at multiple levels in sales, and multiple roles at multiple levels in customer marketing. And that's part of what gave me the confidence to take on the role that I have at Jelmar as a chief sales officer. Yeah. If I didn't have that varied background and that perspective, you know, I've had P&L ownership before, mm-hmm. both from a sales and from a marketing standpoint, you know, I don't think I would be nearly as good as what I hope my employers would currently say that I'm doing right now, you know? Yeah. You know, they're very different disciplines, and I can understand that it most people kind of gravitate towards one or the other. But if you really want to be a general manager, like if you really want to run a company, you really want to run a country or a region, I really believe that you have to have multiple experiences in different disciplines. And it doesn't have to be sales and marketing. It could be marketing and finance. You know, mm-hmm. one of my best friends from SC Johnson, she started her career in finance at SCJ, and she did two or three roles in finance and then actually moved into marketing and is now a director in marketing. You know, and the way that she looks at things with a financial lens is really different than some of her other colleagues. And it makes her a much more rounded general manager. Even though she's a marketing director and she's very focused on that function, she's still launching innovation. So mm-hmm. she's really paying attention much earlier in the process to what is the cost structure, so that you don't get all the way down the path and then you're launching something that doesn't make the
cost. Yeah.
Does that answer your question, Alex?
It does. It does.
Excellent.
And the transition from US to Canada. Obviously, Canada has a work culture. That's one way you kind of described SCJ Canada. What was that like? How did you find it? Did you find it similar, different? What was that experience like for you?
You know, the SCJ culture in Canada was a very close, very tight team, even within the sales organization in Canada. I mean, there's, 50 or 60 people and it's really close. Right. And at the time, there's probably fewer now than there was when I first moved into sales in 2007. You know, and moving to the U.S., it was, all of a sudden it's a much bigger pond. Right. Yeah. And you're kind of this weird unicorn person because nobody really knows who you are and trying to establish yourself. But the thing that I found the most interesting and beneficial was the US just has more resources. Like, if I had a Nielsen question about data, there was like 8 people to ask. Whereas in Canada, there was like 1 and you only had part-time access to them. And, you were like 4th in line after somebody else. So, but you also then had to get used to that bigger pond also meant that there were a lot more people that you had to get aligned to how you wanted to move. So, it is a little bit interesting when you go from Canada and you're like a category manager, category director for Canada. You know, I had total responsibility for the entire Glade business, right? Mm. All of the advertising was under my scope, the whole P&L, that was the scope. And yes, it was a smaller from a dollars and cents standpoint, but the complexity of the business and understanding how they intertwine together, you know, how the scented oils products versus the candles, like all of that mm-hmm. stuff I had total responsibility for. Then I moved to the US when you have a very, a much more focused view. Like you would have, a brand manager and a director on candles, right?
So
the depth that team could get into in the data and really on a customer by customer basis and on a consumer demographic by demographic group basis, like they would know that inside and out, where I never had the ability to get that deep. So I looked at the business in a very broad kind of a general management view and I had to relearn in the US, like, no, I gotta dig deeper. I gotta peel back the layers of the onion, because when I was in a meeting then and I was presenting a plan I wanted to do or a decision I wanted to make to management, the questions that they asked were much more detailed in the depth of really the consumer understanding and the knowledge. So that was one thing that was, not difficult, but it was just something that was really different, because again, you just had so many more people and so many more resources to do that. The US environment is a little bit different. There's there's a little bit more of the, well, we don't talk about these subjects. Like, we don't talk about politics. We don't talk about other things. Whereas in Canada, it's a little bit more common to have those types of personal discussions, you know. And on a personal note, we moved our children down. You know, my youngest son was 7 at the time and my oldest son was 10. And it was difficult getting them into a different school system and, you know, trying to support them, you know, not really understanding the differences between the US and the Canadian school systems are quite different, you know, and that took a little bit of learning. Getting my husband into a place where he could legally work in the US was also, you know, an additional thing. You know, I will say that SC Johnson in specific was amazing, you know, moving us down and the support, you know, working with my family to get us green cards, you know, working to make sure Andrew could get employment and all kinds of things. You know, it really, second to none for how the support we had in moving to the US, you know, lots of help and support, you know. I really have learned a ton, and I, you know, you look back on it and you're like, wow, I left my country and family and that kind of stuff. But, you know, it's really been good for us. You know, and before you ask the question, a lot of people are like, oh, are you going to stay? Are you going to become a citizen? And the answer to that is no, for a number of reasons, but we plan to retire at a minimum back at home. And that's just because we are still staunchly Canadian. We are on phase one of the 4 or 5 step Chadwick return to Canada plan by putting our oldest into university in Kingston. Yes. And, you know, 4 years from now, the second one will absolutely be going to school in Kingston, or not in Kingston, but in Canada. I mean, I'm hoping Kingston.
It sounds like you've already decided it's Queens.
Yeah, I have already decided. Andrew's not quite there yet, but we're working on it. We got 4 years. But, you know, we have worked really hard to maintain a Canadian identity for our family. And when you move to a new country and you just, you very quickly become very nuclear with we were a force because you don't know anybody, right? Like, I knew a few people from work because I worked at SCJ for 14 years before I moved to the US. So I knew a lot of people in the US, but there's a difference between knowing them and talking to them on conference calls and seeing them once a year at the North America meeting and, you know, having lunch versus, hey, you want to come over to my house and, you know, have dinner. It's a very different kind of mindset. And it was a little scary, you know, like, we're trying to support the kids. We're trying to help them make friends. We're trying to make friends. You know, it's been a long time since as adults, we're trying to make real friends. And it's, it was really tough, and it really makes you work together, you know, in a very nuclear way. And it's very similar to what a lot of parents or families have experienced during COVID, you know, because people were home so much more, you know, they really got a lot closer with their immediate family. And we had already done that. So the interesting thing is, for us, COVID wasn't that difficult, because we were already very tied into, you know, it's like the 4 Chadwicks against the world type thing. Whereas a lot of other people hadn't had that type of an experience. And then we also have a benefit. I mean, I think you guys have both been here. You know, we have an 1.5 acre of property and we back onto the woods, and, you know, COVID wasn't as bad when you could get outside and you live in your own park, you know? So, I mean, that worked out really well. And it's certainly a much nicer environment than we would have had in the house that we lived in Cambridge, in Ontario. You know, so there was many aspects of the transition. Obviously, a lot of people ask us questions about the political climate in the US, because, you know, we moved down under Obama and then it wasn't Obama. And, you know, it's a very different political environment than what we're used to. You know, there were some quirky things. You know, suddenly we had our children that had friends that had weapons in the house, and we'd never experienced that before as parents. You know, do we let them go to their house? Do we have a conversation with the parents? Like, what do we do? Because that was never a thing at home. So there's different things about it. But, you know, we love living here. We have created a beautiful bubble of friends, you know, that we've traveled to Europe with. from here. They've come home with us to Toronto for a, you know, for a vacation. You know, we, our kids, you know, my oldest son had the closest group of friends in the last 2 years of his high school experience. You know, so there's many, many benefits that we have gleaned as a family from coming here, for sure.
Yeah, I love that. And we were talking at the beginning, right? The family seems to be thriving. So that's yeah, about all you can ask for.
Yeah, they're doing really well. You know, Andrew works for a small family-owned business. It's funny, we now both work for small family-owned businesses, yeah, very different environments, but as a global HR director. So, you know, he's really happy, and he's only 20 minutes from our house from work. So it, yeah, it works out really, really well.
Awesome. So around that sort of same line, I guess, moving into your new role, Jelmar, you, yep, talked about some of the differences already, right? Moving to from an enormous company, like the SC Johnson head office is enormous. It's a university campus. Yep. And then moving to a smaller company, I think you said 22 people in the office there. What was that transition like?
So it's been really fascinating. You know, you can't hide, you know, and I was certainly never an employee that would like duck under the radar and not, you know, do the minimum. That's never been my style. But with only 22 full-time employees and you at the top, like, man, you're totally exposed. Like, you know, everybody's asking, yeah, your opinion, and it better be smart every time you open your mouth. So there's a lot of pressure in a much smaller environment. You know, the culture, though, is also really different. You know, I would liken SC Johnson to, you know, what they call down here, Minnesota nice, you know, whereas in my organization right now, we have many more, you know, crucial type conversations about making decisions. You know, like if one of the people on my sales team doesn't agree with what we're doing, like he's going to tell me, or she's going to, and we're going to hash it out. We're going to figure out an answer right then, instead of like, well, I didn't really want to say anything, which happens a lot of times at any big org, right? You know, and then the other thing that has taken a little bit of time to get used to, but I love it, is the speed, because I don't have seven people I've got to go get approval from.
Yes.
One, half the time it's me. And the other half of the time it's, you know, my CEO or our chief of staff. And, you know, we'll sit in a room on a Thursday afternoon and we'll be like, okay, well, we want to launch this product and this is what we want in it. And we'll call the R&D head and we'll be like, Raphael, can we have a formula that does this? And he's like, yes. And then in a week and a half, we've got testing with results. And 3 weeks from then, I've got a label and it's through Safer Choice and we have approval. And like, I can start talking to customers in like 6 weeks.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I can't even get a phone call done at a place as big, yeah, as SC Johnson in 6 weeks, yeah, to say we have an, yeah, idea, right? Yeah. So with that also comes the responsibility, right? Because, yeah, it can allow you to run off in tangent, right? Mm-hmm. So what I do miss, or what I am trying to help bring to Jelmar, is a little bit more of the structure and the process that a big company like SCJ, yes, really relies on to make sure that, you know, they're not doing the wrong thing, that they're not launching something in an ad hoc manner, mm-hmm, you know, that doesn't fit with the brand or different things like that. The big benefit is you can just do all of those things faster, right?
Yeah.
There's just significantly fewer people to talk to and get their input and everything else. And then the other thing that I really like about it is because we are so small, we outsource a lot of things, which then gives you an even greater number of different lenses when you're trying to make a decision. So like we have a number of agencies that we work with and we have some really good people that work for us or work with us, you know, and so they help to bring in thought leadership from different businesses that they work for, right? You know, and then I also have a very large broker net because I only have two full-time salespeople. So, but we sell to everybody in the US. And so we actually use brokers for the bulk of our business sales.
Yeah.
And that's been a huge learning experience because, yeah, I used to have, you know, one person was responsible for the air care business at Albertsons, right? Mm-hmm. And now I have this broker who's CA Fortune who is calling on Albertsons for me. So, yeah, I have to now make sure that they understand our business's strategy, our business's product profile. And I have a different broker for almost every single account. So it's not like we have one or two broker agencies. We have 40 of them. And so that's been a very big, that's a very different way to sell. Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, my team and I still, you know, if we have a call with Walmart, I'm actually going to those and the sales, my sales account director who's responsible for that, but we're actually have with the broker. And then, so how do we make sure that our business is high enough on that broker's list that we get the best people on our account, that we get the best service?
Yeah.
You know, so from that, it's a lot of organizational management, you know, on a very interesting scale that, you know, I'm not used to. So that's been a really interesting and really good learning experience, taking it from, I used to have all the control because of the people that worked for me.
Yeah.
It was very clear, as both you guys can probably attest to, and you can talk about me later with the call, but, you know, versus I have the control in the ability that if the broker isn't responding and delivering what we need, then I've got to fire them. But then I got to go find a new broker.
Yeah,
and then I've got to be accepted by the retailer, and then they have to be good.
Start the
and then I have to
over.
Educate them. Right. So, yeah. So that has been very, very different, exciting and, you know, but very, very different, you know? That's so, true. You know, everything between SCJ and Jelmar in the way they go to is different, except that we're both in home clean. That's pretty much the only constant. But that did actually help me because I came in with 21 years. And actually, if you include Procter & Gamble, 23 years of category experience.
Yeah.
I think taking on this level of a role in a category that I had never participated in, you know, if I had moved to a small food company or something, I think it would have been much more difficult for me to onboard and to make an impact and be successful. The fact that I came into a category that I know extremely well and have operated in for, you know, more than two decades, certainly made that transition a lot easier.
Absolutely.
Sarah, question we like to ask people is, in the marketplace right now or recently, is there a brand or product that you either use or have just seen doing great things that you want to highlight?
That's a good question. My favorite brand on what, you know, what they do in the marketplace, and it's not necessarily recently. I think it's a campaign that they've had for a long time. Is the Dove Real Beauty campaign. You know, if I could put my hand on that original marketing proposal, I would love to see it, you know, because they really turned the beauty industry a little bit on its head, right? Because they, and it still sold their product, right? But it didn't sell their product in an unauthentic, fake way. They were like, our product helps you be more beautiful, but also helps you feel more beautiful because it's literally for everybody. And, you know, I have always admired that brand because it's a very simple message and they execute it in such a very clean way. You know, I always look at their visual brand language. It's all white, right?
Yeah.
And the women in their advertising are always wearing white. And so then you can really see very starkly the differences in the way the women look, because you remove all of that extraneous noise within the campaign. So that's probably, it's a program I certainly believe in. You know, I spent more than 2 years running the Global Women's Business Council at SC Johnson. I've been part of those types of organizations and stuff internally my entire career, continuing to advance women and moving out of, you know, a normal or a previous or a stereotypical way of beauty and intelligence for women. I've always admired that campaign because I really think that it was a perfect marriage of the right message and a message that still came across as authentic, but it also haloed back to the brand.
Totally.
And, you know, if you can force fit causes into any brand, and that just kills the authenticity, and it hurts the business and it hurts the cause as well, you know? So that to me is probably my favorite brand over time, because I just think that they have really managed their message properly and has done a really good job.
No, it's a great call out. I think, you know, as you said, it's an inclusive message. So it really applies so broadly in the market, and, you know, it's a positive one. And I also, as you talked about it, it kind of conveys naturalness too, right? Both mm-hmm. in terms of beauty, but also in terms of the product, which, you know, with between yes. the white and everything else. So yeah, it's a great example.
Yeah. So that would be my favorite brand story, I think.
Awesome.
And then, Sarah, the last thing that we want to leave listeners with is sort of like your soapbox moment. So like what what advice would you give to, I mean, you've given Alex and I advice in the past, right? That's been amazing. And you've already given some in this episode, but what advice do you want to leave people with that are starting off their career in CPG to be successful?
Yeah, it's such a great question. And it's actually one I've thought a lot about and have answered a number of times for different groups of people, and probably the two of you included. But it's really to be open to opportunity. You know, like if an opportunity comes along and your first reaction is, I don't really know, that's the opportunity I think you should go try. Because at the end of the day, if you hate it, you can always go and do the next yeah, rotation. Yeah. You can all like your career is, you know, and I know I've said this to both of you, your career is a marathon. And, you know, I've spent a lot of time with junior talent, bringing in interns into the organization. And they're always like, how fast can I get to brand manager? And then how fast can I be a director? And I'm like, hold on, because you're not going to be a good brand manager and you're not going to be a good director. And you're not going to have longevity in your career if you don't have a good foundation and you're open to different options. You know, the best thing about my own career is when I left marketing after 9 years and a lot of success. I was doing just fine in marketing, and I could have had a director role at another company or somewhere else. And I went back to an account manager level in sales. I learned so much more, and it is absolutely informed. And that was, and I remember it at the time, because I remember signing the offer letter and my hand was shaking because I was terrified. I had no idea what I was doing. And, you know, but I had this little voice inside my head saying, just try. Mm-hmm. And there's so many times now that we're competing with other people, or we're just trying to get that next thing, or we're trying to get mm-hmm. ahead. You know, that would be the one thing. And then the other thing I would say, and it's kind of funny since I've just left my organization, but I did stay at SCJ for 21 years. And what I would say is there's a lot of times when people, especially earlier in their career, you know, they work for a couple of years and then they get a headhunter call and the headhunter dangles like an extra $5,000 or, yeah. you know, a cool title or something. And then they're like, I'm out of here. I'm going to go jump. And, you know, I remember a long time ago, we had that problem at SC Johnson. We had a number of people that were leaving in Canada, and John Peoples was the general manager at the time. And he kind of called all of sales and marketing and finance together. And he gave us some really good advice, and it's really stuck with me. And it was about, like, you really need to think about not the next step, but what's the one after that? Because mm-hmm. if you have now jumped to another company and you're now at the top of their pay band, your next promotion, you're not going to make it up. Mm-hmm. You're not suddenly, you haven't moved yourself into the new echelon of compensation. Yeah. You've now just maybe accelerated on a short-term basis your compensation. But what you also have to do is you have to reprove yourself. You have to remake friends. You have to re-get a new sponsor for you from a senior leadership. You've got to figure out a whole new category or an agency. You have to find allies. And those things all take time. And so that may actually delay your next move. Whereas if you had stayed at the company that you were at and continued to grow through cross-functional experiences or even moving up the same silo, I guarantee it, you will get back to that compensation level very quickly, and mm-hmm. it will not have caused you as much stress by having to learn a new environment and new people and what is successful at this company versus this company. So like when I'm hiring people right now, I ask a lot more questions of you know, people who I would term a huge hopper, like that moved every 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, why did you move? Why didn't you stay? You know, like I left Procter & Gamble and moved to SCJ for a very specific reason. I wanted a different culture. And then I stayed there for a very long time, 21 yeah. years. Yep. And then I really wasn't looking, you know, I certainly, you know, was not entertaining recruiters. But I had this person who I really respected reached out and said, hey, I think there's this cool opportunity and it may be something that would be right up your alley. And yes, I did move, but it was a long time and it took me a long time to make that decision.
Good advice. I like it.
Yeah.
Especially as someone who has stayed at SC Johnson.
So. Yes. Yes. There's yeah. value in, there is value in staying, you know, and there, but there's also value in, you know, in finding a new path and moving and doing different things. Because again, as I said, an experience is important yeah. and being open to opportunities are important. I'm just saying that generally speaking, the earlier you are in the career, if you start to hop a number of times, you may not be figuring out what really is bringing you joy, what really is bringing you that challenge that's yeah. going to make you happy and fulfilled and how you build a career into the future.
Makes sense. Makes sense. It's not a great base to build on. And then, you know, the comment, and you hear it all the time, but a career is a marathon, not a sprint. Trying to be a hopper, it's like trying to execute long jumps during your marathon, which is probably a recipe for injury or something else. So
yeah. And I mean, it's interesting when you think about it, right? Like, I mean, I have been in this industry for 24 years. I still easily have another 10 years to go. It's mm-hmm. a long time, you yeah. know, it's a long time. And, you know, you've got to be open to those experiences that help you build that as a big foundation to get to whatever your future goal is. And sometimes the way to get here is not the straight line. Sometimes totally. You got to take a little zigzag. It helps you drive time. It helps you learn. It helps you grow in your career and really give you better exposure and experience. Yeah.
This has been an absolute pleasure. So good to see you.
Yeah.
It's been too long.
Yeah. Well, you can at least come to Racine and still see me occasionally. So the next time you come to Racine, you know, dinner is on us here at the house.
I'm taking you up on it. I promise not to order the Montreal smoked meat sandwich again.
Oh my God. Okay. So if you're going to cut this, that's fine. But I will have to tell your podcast listeners about the Montreal smoked sandwich story. So you got to picture this. We're taking the new interns to Costco. And it was, you know, I did a whole warehouse tour and taught them all about the Warehouse Club channel and Costco. And you're supposed to get like the $1.50 hot dog and drink. And that was the lunch. And so everybody just kind of knew that, but not Alex. He was standing. He's like, well, maybe I should have the chicken sandwich. Or no, I'm going to have the $5.50 Montreal smoked meat sandwich, which is totally fine. But it was really funny because not only did it cost like 3 times more than anybody else's lunch. And, you know, when I submitted the expense report, my boss was like, who bought that? Didn't they know it's supposed to be the $1.50? We also waited for his sandwich because like hardly anybody orders it.
It was incredibly fresh.
It was the best moment. To be fair, we probably poked at Alex a little bit for it. And since it's, 15 years ago, we still do it. But it also was a beautiful unifying moment for you guys as a group of interns. It was really fun. So, I couldn't go by without sharing that.
No, of course, for sure.
It was good. But I mean, it's been so fun to talk to you guys today. And, you know, I'm really excited with what you're doing, both in your careers and, you know, taking this leap and doing this podcast, because it's, you know, you've got lots of things on your plates between relationships and children and jobs. And I'm sure you probably play sports and do all those other good things you used to do. But taking this on and it just reminds me of what you were like when you worked for me years ago, which was, you know, always up for a challenge, always up for something new. And I think it's really cool. And it meant the world to me that you asked me to participate.
Of course. Yeah. You were one of the first people we thought of for sure. Right. Important mentor to both of us in our career, especially early on at SC Johnson. Someone I still text and reach out to on a fairly regular basis. Right. I don't get to go to Racine anymore, but
it's okay.
Yeah. We wanted to have you on for sure. And excited to see all the things you're doing in your career. And of course, we always want to have people on the podcast that say good things about us. So you definitely fit the bill there.
Well, I tried. You know, I did get the memo ahead of time.
We sent her an e-transfer. Yes, that's right.
Yeah, little e-transfer. I do still have a Canadian bank account because I got to pay for Queens for Gavin. So
exactly.
But yeah, no, I couldn't be more thankful and can't wait to see all your success. So make sure you send me links to
absolutely.
Stuff.
Absolutely. We will.
Absolutely.
Cool.
Thanks so much, Sarah.
Thanks, Sarah.
Bye, guys. Thank you. Bye.
That was great to see her.
It really was. Yeah. I haven't seen her in a few years. I don't go down to Racine like you. So I don't think I will go down to Racine probably anytime soon.
Hey, it's been COVID. I haven't gotten down much.
That's true.
I've been once and it was a whirlwind in and out.
That's true.
I've definitely taken her up on that meal. And I will order that sandwich.
And I will order that sandwich. Yeah, I'm just happy to have a podcast where someone says they like me. That's few and far between, so I'll take it. Even if it was sort of a fence sit answer.
We know where she was sitting.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. One of the things that I loved about Sarah as my manager was that she just was one of those people that always had your back. Like when you left a room, there's a process at SC Johnson called MS&D. Basically, you go in, you present your career aspirations, then leadership sort of discusses them after you leave the room. Whenever she was in that room, I just felt like she 100% had my back and it was going to be a great conversation and great things were going to happen for me in my career path. And as a manager, I mean, I'm not sure what more you could ask for.
Without a doubt. I mean, the other thing I really liked about Sarah is just how, you know, we talked about the velvet hammer, but she always tells it straight. And
yeah,
she knows, you know, the right amount of softness to put on whatever coaching or feedback. And honestly, that's so valuable. Like, you don't often have people who are willing to tell you something that's hard to tell you. And Sarah has a lot of courage and willingness to have those types of conversations. So I think that was another great thing about her as a manager. Key takeaway, what do you got?
I think it's the piece around being open to opportunity that I liked. And I think for me, it's, you know, it's something that I think that I've done well, right? Moving across the country about as far away as you can go. And just not turning down different opportunities that come your way, internal or external. Right? Just being able to take chances, do things that maybe make you uncomfortable so that you're stretching yourself. I found in different roles before, maybe I was getting a bit too comfortable and I wasn't feeling challenged enough. And I wanted to find something that did stretch me more. So something that I think was bang on from an advice standpoint and something that's definitely applied to my life. How about you?
I think from my end, it was about the importance of just continual growth, and it's on a similar vein to what you just said, but you know, the cross-functional experience, the not being I'm a marketer, I'm a salesperson, that kind of general management perspective, I think is a huge growth advantage and competitive advantage for anyone in their career, especially in consumer products. I just think the broader you can see the picture, I think, you know, that is only going to make you more effective.
Absolutely. Well, if you haven't already, make sure to like and subscribe. Follow us on all our social media channels. And we'll be back again next week with another interview.
Thanks, guys.
Bye for now, guys.